This is Absolute Radio. I'm Jeff Lloyd. This is my hometime show and in session tonight. I'm hugely excited about this. We have the Blockheads. Hello.
Oi, oi.
Hello, Jeff.
Hi,
hello.
Do you know, I was just reminiscing then. I think my earliest memory of Top of the Pops would be two things. One would be seeing the blonde one out of ABBA and having a strange feeling and thinking, ooh, ladies are different to men and I quite like it. And then the other one would be seeing Hit Me With Your Rhythm Stick. And yeah, here we are. How many years later? Would it be 30 years later?
30.
Wow. And I'm just thinking, probably Chaz is the best person to answer this question. When was the first time you remember being in a room and that word blockhead falling out of somebody's mouth?
Well, what happened was, going way back 30-odd years ago, Ian and I were demoing the song Blockheads that we'd written together.
Yeah.
And Charlie and Norman from Loving Awareness, the band that Johnny... and Mickey were also in at the time. They'd lent out Charlie and Norman as a rhythm section, and they were helping Ian and myself do some decent demos. And so on playback, we were listening back to Blockheads, and Charlie Charles had a copy of the lyric of Blockheads, and he looked at the line, parties of blockheads with shoes like dead pigs' noses, and he glances down at his footwear, and he says, hello, Ian, that's me you're talking about. And Norman, quick as a flash, goes, yeah, we're the Blockheads. And Ian goes, cracked it. And
great.
That was the name jumped off the page and became the band name.
Yeah. And here you are, all these years later, and you've got the album out, Staring Down the Barrel, and Derek's in the band now. In terms of original members of the band, how many are you still in there?
Three of us.
Gallagher, Chaz Jungle, John Turnbull
and
Norman Watright.
It's four of us, sorry. We lost one along the
way. Derek's been with us for a dozen or so more.
Yeah.
He's.
And could you have conceived, you know, sitting listening to that track Blockheads all those years ago, that you would still be making music as a Blockhead all these years later?
You know, I've never been good at looking into the future, you know. I don't really know. It's at the moment, they're making a movie called Sex and Drugs and Rock and Roll. And the interesting thing is, Johnny and I went down to set yesterday, and the question that was asked over and over and over again was, guys, it must be so weird watching yourselves being filmed. Because, you know, like, there's someone playing Johnny when he was 20-odd years old, and myself as well playing me at 27. And the weirdest thing is, it's surreal, but it almost feels like right, because... going back in time when Ian was alive, it was so strong. His energy and what he was doing was so vital that it's almost like it was right that it's carrying on, that his energy and, you know, and his legacy is alive. It should never have been, you know, it shouldn't be forgotten. And, you know, just coming and talking to you, someone like yourself, and knowing the effect that the band had on you.
You know?
I mean, I think a lot of people feel the same way. So it feels right that we're still performing as the Blockheads.
I often think, though, with bands, like, as a fan of bands, bands take on this whole different energy and mystique. And I think about, like, another band they made a film about, Joy Division. So, like, you take that band and you feel as if, like, there's all this strange, dark energy about them and the tortured genius. And then you watch the film and you think about it and you think, oh, it's just a bunch of lads, really, making it up as they were going along. And to some extent, I'm guessing that early days of a band is always a little bit like that.
Well, I don't want to commandeer the mic here, but I did. Let me just say that our band wasn't like other bands.
Yeah.
In the respect that it was very much Admiral Dury. You know, at the helm, and we sort of, you know, fell in the nicest possible way.
You were the foot soldiers.
It's funny that what Chaz said before about when we went to the filming yesterday, and Andy Serkis, who's playing Ian.
Yeah.
In the movie, they couldn't have picked a better chap. And it's like, it is glory days, you know.
Yeah.
It's 78, 79, sort of, we've had a hit.
And
everybody's sort of up for it. But look, we were at the back, like, looking just to see if the set was right. So that's why we're there.
Yeah.
It was a good day's out. But it was spookily, eerily fantastic that we were getting the shivers watching a character... Yeah. actor play Ian.
I was watching the same thing and I felt very excited. Do you know what I think it was? It's the energy, and you're just responding to this incredible torrent of energy which Ian had, and Andy Serkis who's playing Ian, he's got it in space.
Well, he's a phenomenal, like, physical actor, and you look at the work he did with Gollum or King Kong. He takes on characteristics. He's like a physical mimic.
Oh yeah,
yeah, it's
absolutely
an amazing thing.
Yeah.
So Del, I must ask you. They were talking about feeling like Ian was the Admiral. Have you come straight in at the rank of Admiral then?
Have well, you got? No, I've been reeled in from the wings. Really.
Rear
admiral.
Yeah.
I'm a rear admiral.
Chief petty officer. Because
yeah. You're described as part of the Blockheads extended family, and you were Ian's personal minder for a decade.
Yeah, I mean, for want of a better word, minder's all right. I didn't do any minding. I did plenty of cuddling. Not a great deal of chinning.
Yeah, well, I can't imagine you would have to fend off that many intruders and assailants with Ian.
Well, Ian had a reputation long before I come along with his two previous minders. One, which was Fred Spider Rowe, that up until he started working for Ian, had done more time inside than he had on the out. And Sulphate Strangler, who were quite sort of, you know, serious-looking geezers.
Sulphate Strangler?
Yeah, Pete Rush.
Wow.
Ian's, you know, he took over from Fred. And so Ian had a reputation. He didn't mess with Ian's minders because they looked so fearsome. And, you know, so I didn't really have a problem. And I said, I'll come out and, you know, help you up and down the stairs as long as I don't have to chin anybody. And he said, well, from now on, we'll cuddle them. But we normally got to sign the biggest geezer at the gig anyway, normally called Tiny, you know, about as wide as he is broad, and he used to follow us about. And if anything, you know, sort of looked like it was going to hit the fan, I just used to look at Tiny, look at the felon, and, you know, he'd vaporise into thin air, you know, pick him up by the scruff of the neck and deposit him outside. So it was quite good fun.
And having seen it, I suppose, from the other side of the Mike for so long, is it weird being on this side? Is performing something you'd done much of beforehand?
Well, only, you know, only really in my rocking chair, you know.
Yeah.
Yeah, I'd done a little bit of performing, and I used to go and help Ian out with the hit-miss at the end of the gig. So
yeah,
you know, I used to walk him on and walk him off, basically, and join him for a couple of bits. It was pretty frightening, to be quite honest with you, because when the Blockheads crank up, it's all systems go, and there's no place for the faint-hearted. But, you know, I've had loads of encouragement, and slowly catchy monkey, and, you know, here we are 9 years later, and Johnny and I actually, we sort of share it out. Yeah.
An interesting thing also is that a lot of the younger fans that come and see us, they never saw Ian.
Yeah.
They just probably know the word Blockheads better than they know the word Ian Dury.
Yeah, yeah.
So they just come out and, you know, they take it as natural that they don't see a division between the old songs and the new songs.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Whereas older fans would say to us, oh, how many of the old songs are you doing? You know, and they, you know, you hit me as, you know, like,
yeah,
What a Waste and all those tunes. Yeah. And we do about 50-50, we mix it up. But I say, for the young kids, it's just Blockhead music. And,
Just one thing with no break in the middle
you
of
know,
it.
It's, yeah, and possibly in 100 years' time, it might be, you know, the grandsons of the grand, you know.
Yeah, 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 yeah.
Of our...
The next
our
generation,
yeah,
like Star Trek.
I could see it carrying on, because now and again, we have to drop out, us, you know, musicians in our band have other gigs as well. And you know what? It always sounds good. Even if one of us drops out, the music somehow, you know, is buoyant enough to sort of withstand a member sort of dipping out.
Yeah. You know?